For what purpose does the gentleman from California seek recognition?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the House suspend the rules and pass the bill H.R. 1964 as amended.
The clerk will report the title of the bill.
H.R. 1964, a bill to provide for the recognition of the Lumbee Tribe of North Carolina and for other purposes.
Pursuant to the rule, the gentleman from California, Mr. Huffman, and the gentleman from Utah, Mr. Bishop, will each control 20 minutes. The chair recognizes the gentleman from California.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I ask a unanimous consent that all members may have 5 legislative days to revise and extend their remarks and include extraneous material on the measure under consideration.
Without objection, so ordered.
Mr. Speaker, I yield myself such time as I may consume.
The gentleman is recognized.
H.R. 1964, the Lumbee Recognition Act, introduced by our colleague from North Carolina, Mr. Butterfield, will finally extend recognition to the Lumbee Tribe of North Carolina. The Lumbee Tribe resides primarily in Robeson, Hoke, Cumberland, and Scotland counties of that state, has approximately 60,000 members. That means it's the largest tribe in North Carolina, also the largest tribe east of the Mississippi River, and the 9th largest tribe in America. In 1885, this tribe was recognized by the state of North Carolina. It then sought federal recognition from the United States in 1889, and they've been seeking that recognition ever since. Over the past 130 years, numerous bills have been introduced in Congress to federally recognize the Lumbee people, resulting in a record of hearing transcripts and committee reports. In addition, numerous academic studies have been undertaken on Lumbee ancestry, and reports have been requested and filed by the Department of Interior on the tribe's validity. All of these documents consistently conclude one thing. The Lumbee people are indeed a distinct self-governing Indian community that's been continuously and undeniably present in the Robeson County area. In 1955, the Lumbee tribe sought federal recognition. Unfortunately, this was during the era known as the termination era, when the United States sought to terminate relationships with tribal governments and force the assimilation of indigenous people into mainstream American society. And to that end, the Department of Interior recommended that Congress amend the legislation to deny eligibility for the benefits and services available to the tribe recognized under the bill. Congress then enacted this amended legislation in 1956, giving it the dubious effect of simultaneously federally recognizing the Lumbee tribe and then effectively terminating that recognition. In 1987, the Lumbee tribe again attempted to restore their federal recognition, this time through the newly created federal acknowledgement process at Interior. However, the department determined that the tribe was ineligible to participate in that process because Congress, pursuant to that 1956 act, had terminated the relationship with the tribe, and therefore only Congress could restore the relationship. That is exactly what enactment of this bill will accomplish. Federal recognition is the formal establishment of a government-to-government relationship between the United States and a tribal nation. Its importance to tribes cannot be overstated. Federal recognition allows a tribe to establish a homeland and to put land into trust to protect future generations. This, in turn, allows the tribe to manage its own resources, gives them control over local jurisdiction and taxation issues. Recognition also entitles tribal people to distinctive benefits, including eligibility to participate in many federal programs, including health care and education. That's why enactment of this bill is so vital to the Lumbee people and why they've been seeking federal recognition for so very long. Other tribes that were terminated by congressional action have come before Congress, and they've had their relationship reestablished through legislation. It is finally time that we act on that prerogative and extend federal recognition to the Lumbee tribe. I want to thank Representative Butterfield for being the champion of this bipartisan legislation and urge its quick adoption. With that, I reserve the balance of my time.
The gentleman reserves. What purpose does the gentleman from Utah seek recognition?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman is recognized.
Thank you very much. I wish to yield 5 minutes to the gentleman from North Carolina who has the proper last name, if not the correct first name, but Representative Bishop, for as much time as he may consume.
The gentleman is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the ranking member for yielding. Since 1885, the state of North Carolina has recognized the Lumbee Indians of North Carolina, but today marks the first time in U.S. history since the Lumbee first sought federal recognition in 1885 that legislation for full and bona fide recognition will pass the U.S. House while a companion bill awaits action in the U.S. Senate, strongly favored by two North Carolina senators, and with the President of the United States having promised to sign the legislation that will result. For 64 years, the 66,000 strong Lumbee have existed in a kind of official limbo that reflects the worst of our federal government. In 1956, Congress passed a law simultaneously granting recognition of the tribe and terminating it according to the movement of that era. Nothing in this act, said the legislation, shall make such Indians eligible for any services performed by the United States for Indians because of their status as Indians, and none of the statutes of the United States which affect Indians because of their status as Indians shall be applicable to the Lumbee Indians. One wonders if they had heard about equal protection. For the opponents of Lumbee recognition, including other tribes, it has always been about the money. And of course, there have been fellow travelers motivated by racial prejudice or neglect. It cannot be disputed, though, that the Lumbee have for three centuries been a cohesive and distinct community of Aboriginal origins and durable institutions, especially schools, living near the Lumber River, which was known until 1809 by the unfortunate but accurate name Drowning Creek. Although the Lumbee have also been known by other names, the Croatan, the Shawraw of Robeson, the Suwan Indian community of Lumber River, they are the continuously present and vital people shown on a map drawn in 1725, whose common modern surnames appear on a document written in 1771, such as Locklear, Chavis, Deese, Sweat, and Groom. They are the Lumbee who were living in Long Swamp in the 1730s, the community now known as Prospect, where I visited just weeks ago. My maternal forebears were Kinlaws in Bladen County, adjacent to Robeson. We also trace a genealogy to the early 1700s, and our family name evolved, like the Lumbees did. We were once McKinlaws, and before that, McKinlucks, desperately poor, but independent Scots-Irish from the borderlands of the English Civil Wars. I can only imagine what it would mean to me to have been singled out by the United States government for centuries of official disregard and denial of my very identity. That is the longstanding injustice that we are correcting today. And the happy ending is already being written by the Lumbee themselves. I know the Lumbee. I know the Warriors Ball and Lumbee Homecoming, UNC Pembroke and Old Main, the Lumbee Cultural Center, and even the Cozy Corner. The Lumbee are supremely patriotic Americans, God-fearing and washed in the blood, devoted to the liberating cause of education and to civic involvement, proud of their community, loving and welcoming to strangers. They are the best of America. And the only honorable course for the United States Congress is to accord them their due recognition at long last. Thanks to Representatives Butterfield, Hudson, Grijalva, and to Ranking Member Rob Bishop, staunch supporters of the Lumbee's pursuit of justice, and also to President Trump, when I had the right moment to bring this to the President's attention, in characteristic fashion, he made no promises other than to give it a close look. And when he decided to throw his support behind recognition, he did it all the way, including traveling to Lumberton to tell the Lumbee himself. Today is a gratifying capstone for my first partial term in the U.S. House. I urge us unanimously to pass the Lumbee Recognition Act, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields. Gentleman, where is California is recognized?
Mr. Speaker, I yield such time as he may consume to the gentleman from North Carolina.
Gentleman from North Carolina is recognized.
Thank you very much for yielding time this afternoon, and thank you, Mr. Speaker, for recognizing me. I rise, Mr. Speaker, in strong support of H.R. 1964, the Lumbee Recognition Act. I urge my colleagues to vote for its passage. Let me just take a moment to thank the chairman of the committee. He's not here today, Mr. Grijalva. I thank him so very much for his friendship and for his leadership on this issue. I thank you, Mr. Huffman, for managing the floor today and recognizing me for just a few moments. And to the ranking member, Mr. Bishop of Utah, I thank you so very much, sir. You are the ranking member of the committee, and I thank you for your leadership as well. I particularly want to thank Mr. Hudson. I don't see Mr. Hudson on the floor, but I know he's very close by. And to my friend, Mr. Bishop, I want to thank both of them for their unwavering support for this legislation. I might say that Robeson County, someone mentioned Robeson County a few minutes ago, it's actually Robeson County, is a part of Mr. Bishop's 9th Congressional District. This bill, Mr. Speaker, will finally extend full federal recognition to the Lumbee Tribe of North Carolina, make its members eligible for the same services and benefits provided to members of other federally recognized tribes. Most importantly, the bill will establish, once and for all, the Lumbee Tribe as an independent and sovereign entity under federal law. North Carolina, as Mr. Bishop, I believe, or either Mr. Huffman mentioned a moment ago, has recognized the Lumbee Tribe since 1885. And this body even recognized the Lumbees in the 1950s. But during the dark days of the termination era, they refused to allow the Lumbee Tribe access to federally funded services and benefits. Almost all of the tribes that were terminated in this troubling era have since been restored to federal recognition. We are long overdue in delivering the same justice to the Lumbee Tribe. This legislation, Mr. Speaker, has tremendous bipartisan support, as you can see today, tremendous bipartisan support that has only accelerated over the past few months. At the end of September, under Chairman Grijalva's leadership, the Natural Resources Committee passed this bill by a voice vote. It was non-controversial. Shortly thereafter, Democratic leader Steny Hoyer announced his support for full federal recognition for the Lumbee Nation and his intention to bring the bill to the floor. Mr. Hoyer told me, and he told Chairman Godwin in a telephone call a few weeks ago, that he would bring this bill, H.R. 1964, to the floor on November the 16th. Today is November the 16th. Then, during the presidential campaign, Joe Biden gave his unconditional support to this legislation. And President Trump, as Mr. Bishop said, did so as well. Now is the time for the House to get this done. When this legislation passes, it is my fervent hope that our Senate colleagues from both parties will support passage and send it to the President's desk for his immediate signature. In closing, Mr. Speaker, let me remind the House that this legislation has been before this body many times over the years since I have been in Congress. I recall Democratic Congressman Mike McIntyre repeatedly introducing this legislation. In the 110th and the 111th Congress, the House passed this legislation, but it never, ever saw the light in the other body. It appears that the legislation now has the support of Senators Burr and Tillis. I'm not suggesting that they didn't support it previously. It was another time and another Congress. But it appears that the legislation has the support of Senator Burr and Senator Tillis, and it should be favorably considered in the Senate. Therefore, I respectfully ask my colleagues to extend a hand of friendship to the 66,000 members of the Lumbee Nation and grant them their long overdue full federal recognition. I ask my colleagues to vote aye on H.R. 1964. I yield back.
The gentleman yields back. The gentleman from California reserves.
And Mr. Speaker, I ask unanimous consent to enter into the record an email from the CBO. While we do not have an official CBO score, we do have this email today confirming that the bill will not affect direct spending or revenues, and I request unanimous consent to enter it in the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
I reserve the balance of my time.
The gentleman from Utah is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield myself such time as I may consume. This longstanding issue has been one that has been before many Congresses, so I appreciate Mr. Butterfield for his efforts and Mr. Bishop and both of you North Carolina representatives for bringing your state together and coming up with a cooperative way of doing it. The issue with Lumbees has had several, goes back to 1956 as has been mentioned, but also had, starting in 1988, 89, and finishing in the last administration, conflicting opinions from solicitors of the Interior Department that have caused this problem regarding the Lumbee Tribe on what they may or may not pursue as far as administrative recognition or other issues that are dealt with. So the proper way when there are conflicting opinions, especially coming from the executive branch, is for Congress to step up and do its responsibility and its duty. And that is what House Bill 1964, which was a wonderful year for me, I remember it very well, 1964 does is allow Congress to do its responsibility by taking these conflicting opinions and stating what is the purpose and intent of Congress. That is the right way of doing things. Far too often have we tried to use administrative shortcuts when in essence we find out that it produces long-term problems for us. So I commend Representative Bishop of North Carolina, not only for a great name, but also for the fact that you are representing your constituency extremely well, but you're doing it in the proper way in bringing a piece of legislation to us through markup. I appreciate also the letter that was mentioned by Mr. Huffman as well, because it is significant. One of the things the majority party still has to do is make sure there is a CBO score attached to this bill, perhaps before it goes all the way through. But we have overlooked those in the past. We don't need to necessarily overlook them in the future going through there. But I appreciate what you are doing with this process. It's a positive thing, and I would urge all the members who are here or who are not here to pass this one in the affirmative, because it's something that needs to be done, and I applaud those who have worked so hard to get unity within the delegation from North Carolina to move forward with it. And with that, I yield back. I reserve.
The gentleman reserves. The gentleman from California is recognized.
Mr. Speaker, I request an aye vote and yield the balance of my time.
The gentleman yields.
They yield.
Gentleman from Utah yields. The question is, will the House suspend the rules and pass the bill H.R. 1964 as amended? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. In the opinion of the chair, two-thirds being in the affirmative, the rules are suspended, the bill is passed, and without objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table.